was in February 21st in 1982. And this the black capitalist that they wrote a story about. And that's me right there.
Wow. And that's Dallas Morning News.
That was the Dallas Morning News. Now, this was the front page, and this is the other page that they wrote. And that's me right there, talking about my life in Dallas.
That is amazing. Wow.
Well, it just so happened that I took all of that stuff I had out, then I'm doing all of my research and putting it together to be for my book.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm definitely going to get somebody to do a film for.
Well, it's coming. I know it is.
Look, all of this is stuff that I have got over the years. And this was given to me from Governor Clement. As an outstanding citizen in the state of Texas. And this was in 1980. And this goes with that.
Wow. That is amazing.
That's a gift shop I had at DFW. Let me show you this first. That's my first picture on the radio at KLIF.
That's proof in the pudding. Young guy too, wasn't
he? Yeah, see that? Age 19.
Age 19.
1949.
Wow. And you know, I thought Cousin Lenny was the first black at KLIF. No.
I was also on KGKL. And WRR.
Wow.
I think I was the only one that had been on three stations.
Yeah.
This is something that's very, very unique. When I was president of the Pylon Sailmanship Club, we felt like the state of Texas were not giving us attention with some of the businesses that we had that we couldn't get contracts. And we decided in one of our meetings at the Pylon Sailmanship Club for us to get a group and go down and talk to the governor, Governor Connally. And this was in 1968.
Wow.
And I went down in his office and talked to him. That's when we took the pictures.
I was at El Centro College at that time.
Really? Yeah. Oh, this was one of the things.
Wow, that that's clean myself. There.
Yeah. This was a brand new Rolls Royce I bought to show myself that I was capable of doing things I didn't know I could do.
And this was 19 when?
I think it was in 84, I think. Yeah.
Wow.
And I was on the Texas Vending Machine Commission there.
Man, it is a pleasure to meet you.
This is the lady that was on television when I had my business out there. I knew her, and she was on the Jeffersons.
Mm.
And we went together to a church, and it was a real, real nice church that a lot of celebrities, black celebrities, went to. And it's called the City of Angels.
And that was in L.A.?
That was in L.A.
Okay.
And this is one of my pride and joys. This is Thurgood Marshall in 1976 when they built the law library for him at Texas Southern. And that was on February the 14th,
1976. Man.
This is something that was very, very unique here. They had on the Wall Street Journal, they did a program one weekend for the black entrepreneurs in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And we formed a committee from here in Dallas. I was the chairman, and that's what that was.
Wow.
And we represented Dallas.
And you represented well, brother.
Yeah. And I got this. This was an award that they sent us after that. And these were some of the black officers that was working with the Wall Street Journal.
Mm.
And that's me, and that's my chairman. His name was David Perry.
Okay.
This, I had the first store in DFW Airport. In the airport. It was in the Braniff Terminal at Gate 4.
And when was that?
I don't see if I got a date on it. Okay. And that was my wife there.
Beautiful.
And now this is a story that really thrills me. When I got that new Rolls Royce, mm-hmm. I drove it to Washington because I had my business up there.
Right.
And when we left, and this was in an inauguration with older Governor Bush and Ronald Reagan.
Mm-hmm.
And we went to that for Joe Curvin, one of the leaders here in Dallas. And when I got my car, it was a gold-colored car. And I drove it in when we got out. And the manager of the hotel, Waldorf Astoria, called me and said, "Mr. Show," said, "would you mind when you come, don't drive your car in the garage. Park it out front, please."
You're going to help him. He wants you to just leave it right out front.
Yeah, that
and
is.
And style right, it right out front of the hotel.
That's another one. Every time I come in, we get out and they leave it parked right there.
Yeah, bring class to his hotel.
Yeah. And you know what? I heard about that when I was a kid on the radio. Wasn't no television there. Every governor or everybody, king or queen, whoever, they would come to New York, they'd be at the Waldorf Astoria. And I remember that. And when I said, "We're going to Waldorf Astoria."
That is amazing.
That's another car I bought, and I kept it 1 month, and I drove it down to New Orleans, and the guy wanted to buy it.
And so you went on sold it to
him. I went on sold to him, yeah. That's when we went to the inaugural ball. My wife and I. And this was a little program that we had right out here. And this is the guy that used to be on Channel 13. Bob
Ray Sanders.
Bob Ray Sanders, yeah. And this was some of our... This guy here, R.C. Hickman, was a business partner
of mine. I met R.C. Hickman. I saw some of his drawings and stuff.
Yeah, and you know, he had the Dallas Express. He was a...
Right.
And all of the lawsuits and all that in the state of Texas, well, he's the one that did that because they did it for the paper. And this is my lover and sweetheart. And this is Mahalia Jackson.
Oh, man.
And she had a first cousin, Father Franklin, here in Dallas. And I put Father Franklin on the radio on Sunday nights. And we got to be real good friends. But every year, he would have Mahalia to come to Dallas to do a program called The Old Ship of Zion.
Mm.
And she would come and stay for a week kind of resting. And I met her personally, and I just loved that woman. I tell you, she was so
one of
sweet.
A kind.
Yeah, she tried. And you know what? We would be eating dinner over there. And all of a sudden, something would strike her. She quit eating and started to singing.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, I tell you.
And it was a show.
Yeah. And this is one of my friends, Lou Rawls. And one of my friends that lived in Austin. And that was me and my wife. And that's Lou Rawls.
Yep. Loved his music.
Yeah. Now, these are my personal friends. Red Garland. You know, he played, and he was just such a celebrity. And you know, he played with Miles Davis.
Right.
And when he started to come into Dallas, and I met him, and he would be over at the nightclub over there, and he and I would meet, because his mother got sick, and he stayed here about 5 years, and he quit traveling anyway, and we got to be great friends, and that's the picture that I took with him.
Oh, yeah.
And I went to his funeral.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I tell you. Now, this is something that will kind of hit you. You know who that is?
Yes. Ben Carson story. Wow.
That suit is going to be the only black on Trump's.
That's right.
And he's going to be the head.
Over housing, right?
He's going to be over housing.
Yeah.
But he and I, this is where we were at Lincoln High School, and we were over there, and I was introducing him. See, I'm introducing him, and he's sitting right there. Uh-huh. And this was right out here in that hallway.
Oh, man.
Just right here. Uh-huh. This is me and Joe Kirby when I opened up my gift shop out at DFW.
Wow.
This was a regional director of HUD here in this district.
Wow.
Don Babels, you probably know here.
I don't know him personally, but I know the name.
Yeah. Those men, my boys. And this one right now is 65. This one's 64.
Yeah, they're in my category.
Yeah. This is one of the personal letters that Mayor Eric Johnson wrote me in September 11th, 1979. Whoa. And you know what? I got a lot of letters, and this was from the one of the police captains. Because I wrote him a letter and told him how proud we was of some of the things that they were trying to do in South Dallas.
That's good.
And I got a lot of these. And this was Ernest Dean, who was the manager of DFW.
Mm-hmm.
And he and I were real, real good friends. And they had a conference here at the DFW. And I told him, I said, well, we're going to make you feel proud. And when the president of the organization, I took my Rolls Royce and picked him up. And he, Arthur Davis and Reba D came to Dallas one year, and they were gonna be here a month with a series of programs that they were doing for the Channel 13 for mm-hmm. all over the country,
mm-hmm.
and they came here. And I had a friend that was working for Channel 13 then, and she called me and said, Dave, I said, yeah. She said, would you do me a favor? I said, sure, I do. Yeah, what? She said, Ozzy Davis and Ruby D are coming in, and I want you to pick them up for you in your Rolls Royce. I said, I'll be delighted to.
I know that's
right. And that whole month they was here, I was going in and out of the house and all that, and taking her to the store and all that. Oh, yeah, that's just.
Y'all became great friends. Huh?
Yeah. And there's my good partner, Ray. But now this was my really, really good partner.
Nat King Cole.
And then Ray Charles, we got to end up being real good friends.
Wow.
And that's my love of that Nancy Wilson. Oh, I used to love her. Look, I got a picture right here on my desk.
I know it. Now she is the queen.
Yeah, I tell you. This I was really crazy about. And every time he come to Dallas, I'd always be there. Billy Eckstein. One time he came down to the Fairmont and he brought his daughter with him.
Wow.
And that's the other picture. Same about it. I met Chappie James in California because I had a friend who was a judge in Washington, D.C. And we went out there to a meeting once, and I got a chance to meet Chappie James. And of course, these, Gene and I were real, real good friends. Gene Harris,
mm-hmm.
With the three sons. I mean, he was just really super. And all these I knew.
Oh, yeah. J.T. was the one.
And I got a chance to meet Winnie. Winnie came to Dallas, and whoa. She was out at Lincoln High School. And I just heard about it one morning, and I got up, and I got ready, and we went
right
out there.
Over there.
Yeah, and I just loved the speech that she gave to us. And that's when he was in prison.
Right.
But it was just so special to meet her and talk to her. And do you know what? Let me tell you. There's my lady.
Hey.
Yeah. And that's my daughter, and that's my wife. And this is my good piano partner. I met Randall too. He came out to one of the, you know, we had the black bookstore out in
Emma Rogers.
Yeah, Miss Rogers. Yeah. I met him out there.
Emma Rogers on the board I serve on.
Really? You know what? I want to meet her because I'm trying to get I want to get a shopping center put out in Lancaster. I got some property out there. It's this property right here.
Mm-hmm.
And that's my property. I sold this right here so they could build this Home Depot here.
Mm.
And this is the Walmart. And I got 5.5 acres right here behind Walmart.
Wow. Now that's smart there.
Yeah.
So you got the traffic already.
This was the regional director of the FAA when I worked at the DFW airport. This is one Mr. Mayor and the Mayor Pro Tem, George Allen.
Right.
And that's another mayor there, Bobby Folsom. Bobby and I were real, real good friends. He had a construction company. He'd give me all of his contracts to clean up his business in construction.
That'll keep you busy there.
Oh, yeah.
Now, this is a blessing.
Yeah. This, I tell you, Flip Wilson, he was crazy. And I met him and we talked. We was at Lake Tahoe.
Wow.
And this is Bunker Hunt. At that time, he and his brother had conquered all the silver in the world. And this guy here was a real, real good friend of mine. He had an Oldsmobile franchise from General Motors.
Mm-hmm.
And we got to be real, real good friends when I had my business out there. He's such a wonderful guy, and he died real early. But he was so nice.
Oh, man.
And that's Thurgood Marshall again.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, I got
You got some things to tell and show.
In 1949 was my first. In the last of 1949, Nat King Cole came to Dallas, stayed two days. And Mr. Parker and I, he was like my second father. And he told me, he said, Dave, you don't need to be in Dallas. He said, you need to come to California because I can help you. These people here in Dallas, they're not going to... Because when he got here, and I told him, I said, okay, we're going to have to go out to the station. I mean, to the place where the ball was going on. And it was a black program. And when we went out there, well, you know, Dallas was so segregated until the white people... moved up where we had a part roped off that was celebrities and people like that in Dallas. And these white folks came in early and they started all of those areas that had been placed off for us. The white folks came in there first and sit in them. And I told Nat, I said, man, we can't do this. I said, you know, I'm on the radio. If this get out tomorrow, man, I said, I won't have no radio show. We want to do something. He said, well, what are we going to do? I said, we can't let them sit here. And so he said, well, I tell you what, I'll go over and talk to him if you go with me. I said, I'll go with you. And he went over, and that was so smooth and so cool. And the two of us, I told him that I was the radio announcer because I introduced him and all that. And I said, this particular area that is roped off for the people that were in love because Nat sang so many love songs. So every race is doing. I said, now, if you're not in love, you can't sit here. So the blacks sit with the whites because if you had somebody you was in love with, you were sitting there. And you know what? They just loved it.
I bet they did.
They did. They really, really did. And Dad said, look, man. He told me, he said, Dave, you just got to come. And he said, look, he was with Capitol Records. Capitol Records had him. And Nancy Wilson had just come on, and they had a lot of other stars. And they also had Frank Sinatra. And Nat told me, he said, Dave, you know what? I sell more records worldwide than Frank Sinatra. Those people don't know nothing about him. And I said, you do? He said, yeah. And that's why I want you to come to California, and we can get you on a radio station. You can really be somebody. And but I never did go. I never did go, but I tell you, it was really something.
So now what about these other stars you were telling me about?
Ray Charles. I got a good story.
Okay, well, let's hear about Ray.
Okay, Ray came to Dallas. I was already on the radio. And he used to come over to a place called La Rose Room over there on Hall Street. And we had another guy that was real, real popular named Amos Milburn. And so he was the star that was there that night. And so when Ray Charles come in, he was trying to get his group organized with some of the Lincoln High School where I finished from to come on the show. And I knew Fathead and a couple of other guys. And anyway, he came over there and he said, Mr. Parker, I want to try to play just two or three songs. And he said, but Mr. Parker said, well, you got to go and see. They used to call me Little Man. You have to go see Little Man because, well, I don't have nothing about the radio. So I went, and I was the first one to start having programs from the programs exactly where it was coming from.
Mm.
And nobody else was doing that at that time.
Right.
And consequently, Ray came and he said, well, you going to be on? I said, look, man, we don't have time to let you on Ray. We didn't, we, and then, too, you sound too much like Nat King Cole. I mean, he's, you know, and he didn't like that. He went back and told Mr. Parker, Mr. Parker, he is not going to let me come on. And so Mr. Parker said, Dave, let him go ahead on, little man, and see what he can do. I said, look, I'm going to let you pay for 10 minutes while in the mission. Just go.
You gave Ray a little short.
Yeah, and you know, Ray got mad at me, you know, and he played 10 minutes and he got off. And let me tell you, 15 years later, after Ray got to be a big star, I had a business in Los Angeles. And I had a business in Dallas, Los Angeles, and Washington, D.C. And I was catching the red eye back to Dallas, and it just so happened Ray was in the airport, and I saw him, and I hadn't seen him since that night, and I went over and talked to him. It was about 1 o'clock in the morning. I said, Brother Ray, he said, what's happening? You know, that's what he'd say all the time, and I said, you know me, and as soon as I tell you, you're going to know it was. And I said, do you remember when we was in Dallas? And he said, you little man. He said, why did you do me like that? I don't care what you said now. I'm somebody now. See, if you were still over there, I'd be with you.
I know that's right. That's funny. That is too funny.
I tell you.
It's a small world.
Yeah, it really was. And B.B. King, he was almost like a brother. Because Mr. Parker had to bail him out. A lot of times he'd go on the children's circus and do these little small towns, and the people wouldn't pay him. So he had to call Mr. Parker and say, I can't get home. So he'd bring him back here to Dallas, and they'd have a show where he could make some money. I mean, it was just really unbelievable.
Boy, and that's amazing.
Yeah.
And so you were the first black voice on KLIF.
Yes. And let me tell you, you know, we talked about divine intervention.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you how I got on the radio. Because nobody just dreamed we would have no black on radio in 1949.
For real?
What happened is a friend of mine, we were listening to the ball game. And I said, do you know that's Gordon McClendon's recreating the baseball? He said, no, they some kind of way, they either gave pictures of it or some kind of recording. I said, no, man. He said, he got the sounds and all that in there, and he's going with his voice up and down. He said, no. I said, I bet you $5.
Mm.
He said, okay. We go over while Gordon McClendon is recreating those old ball games they had in the 1900s early. And the receptionist let us go in and sat in the little studio and looked at him through the window. So when he got off, he said, well, how do you young boys think I did? I said, you know what? Mr. McClendon, you did a wonderful thing. Do you know you got listeners? And I tell you, people, I said, but let me tell you something. All of your listeners, when you get off, and you got this radio station, you put these classical music in there. I said, all the Negroes, because that's what we were called then.
Mm-hmm.
All the Negroes put it on something else. So they tried to find some music that they like. It wasn't too much of ours on there. I said, but then let me tell you what you ought to do. I said, you ought to get somebody to play records that Negroes like.
Mm.
Like Nat King Cole and people like that. And Louis Jordan and all that. He said, that would really, really be good. So I kept talking to him. I said, you really ought to do that. He said, you know what? If I could find somebody to do that, I really would. I said, but you know, you're finding somebody, they have to know how to operate the controls, and they have to get their own music, and they have to sell all the spots to go on. I said, look, I can do every bit. He said, you know what? I really believe you can do that. Because you didn't convince me. He said, I tell you what, we're going to try it out. And you put it together, and I'll put you on. That's how I got on the radio.
Just like that.
Just like
divine.
That. Yes.
Now, let me ask you one more question.
Yeah.
Bill Blair. You remember Bill Blair?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That was my friend, too.
When Bill started his little paper, he was having a lot of hard time. And I had an office. I had a janitorial service. And Curtis Cokes and I had a little construction company where we do alleys and all that stuff in South Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
And so I found out that he was having trouble. And so I told him, I said, look, you come on over and I'll give you a room that we had over on Hatchet. And I gave him a room and for about six or 8 weeks, his business. He did his paper over that. So I knew Blair. He knew me real well, too.
That's good. That's good. We talked about Negro baseball a lot of times.
Yeah. And well, he knew me real, real well.
That's good.
Yeah. And he was real, real important here for a long time because of the baseball career that he had. And he really was a nice guy. He just believed in us like I do.
Right. What about Al Liscombe?
Al Liscombe was a guy that wanted to do something for Dallas and he didn't know how, so he started demonstrating and all that kind of
right.
stuff. And he fooled around and got them to change the number of people that was on the city council and all that, and he was one of the first groups that got on that. But before then, Mr. Galloway. I was president of the Pylon Salesmanship Club.
You kidding?
No, I was one of the organizers of that first.
That is amazing.
Yeah, and I had a lot of influence with the mayors and all that, and so I was running my janitorial service, and they said, "Well, we getting ready to put somebody on the city council, but at first, we're not gonna do like everybody else to get them elected. We're gonna." Just put one on there, and the council agreed with that, and said, we would like for you to do it. I said, look, I don't have time to do that. And he said, well, who's your... I said, I think you ought to do Mr. Galloway. He knew a lot of people in here, and he was real, real popular. And they said, okay, if you think he'll be all right, and that's who they put on there first.
All right. See, I actually got involved with Pylon Salesmanship Club a little
Did
bit,
you
too.
Be, yeah. It must have been after I left.
After you had left.
Yeah. I got something. Let me show you. You know, I'm a dreamer. But when I dream a dream, I try to make the dream come true.
Okay.
And Mayor Eric Johnson, that owned Texas Instrument, he and I got to be real, real good friends because I worked with him on the Goals for Dallas. And this was where he would have citizens come to a meeting and tell what they would like to see Dallas do.
Right.
And he was a people person. And after I started doing that, we got to be real, real good friends.
Man, this is history.
Yeah. And he told me, he said, well, I tell you what, I would really like for you to be on the Goals for Dallas. And I was on the Goals for Dallas. And let me tell you, one of the strangest things that happened, this is what put me into the position of knowing this was divine intervention. The blacks in Dallas did not want to vote for the Crossroads Bond Program. It was going to be a DFW. At that time, it was going to be the largest airport in the world when it was completed, and it was. And also, the new City Hall was in that same program. And he found out that some of the preachers didn't want to vote for it because they said it wasn't going to benefit us at all. They're going to build a lot in North Dallas, and maybe we might have a few jobs out there, but that's not going to help us. And so we're just not going to vote for it because they don't put nothing out here in the bond program for us. And so Mayor Johnson called me, and he said, Dave, I see him. He said, well, oh, come over here. I want you to think about something for me because I found out that a lot of the preachers and the community in Dallas wasn't going to vote to put the airport in. I said, really? He said, yeah. And so when I went out there and told him, he said, you know what I would like for you to do? He said, I would like for you to find out from some of the intelligent people that you know, some of the doctors and the lawyers like Dr. Flowers and Dr. Pinkston and all that, and said, just ask them why is it they feel like the majority of the blacks don't really want to work and vote for the Crossroads Bond Program? So I went out, and I had some people on the street, some from the beer taverns and all that, and some of the doctors and people like Dr. Caesar Clark from his church, and which was Good Street. And I found out that all of the blacks were saying, well, we don't want to vote for it because they don't never put nothing in the black community, but they want us to vote for it. And I said, you know, I can understand that. And I know, I say, I agree with you. I think we ought to be in that some kind of way.
To get a benefit.
It's going to benefit our community too. So I went out and told Mayor Johnson. I said, Mayor Johnson, I can understand why they feel that way. And you know how racist Dallas is. Mm. He said, yeah. I said, they said, why should we go out of our way to vote for something that they're going to spend all these millions of dollars out there for, an airport that maybe we might go and maybe we might get a job and all that? And he said, well, Dave, what we're going to have to do, we're going to have to find something to put in that Crossroads Bond Program in South Dallas. I said, well, okay then. And so he called me one day. He said, I think I got it. He said, what? He said, up in St. Paul, Minnesota, they built a little small building in the black community. And what they did was let you pay your water bill and do a little things that you would normally go down to town to do. Do it right there in the neighborhood. I said, yeah. I said, now that's what the beef is. They said, it's not going to do us any good. He said, we're going to fix that. Hmm. And he told me, he said, I want you to go and find out what they have built. Come back and tell me. I went and I said, Mayor, I didn't see nothing but just a little building. They go in and pay their water bill and tell them what's going on in their neighborhood. And that's all. He said, well, you know what we're going to do? I said, what? We're going to make them really want it now. He said, we're going to build a building and it's going to be more than one building. And then he went to naming the things and he was going to put out that. He said, this is going to be a building supported by the city. You can pay your water bills out there. You can have church out there if you want to because it's going to be a nice building. They don't want to pay for nothing. And any service that they want to find out, they can have a meeting out there. They don't have to come downtown. And we're going to make it so good. And he said, plus, I'm going to do a library. We're going to do a new recreation facility with a nice park and everything. And everything that you see now. And at first, it was called the Crossroads Program. And then, you know what the name of it is now?
What is it?
Martin Luther King.
Martin Luther King Center.
And he told me, yeah. He said, Dave, I know very few blacks know what you did. He said, do you know that you did something for Dallas that was very, very beneficial? To go out and say, we didn't get as many votes as we wanted to, but we got some enough where we know they were supporting it. And he said, Dave, you really ought to be on the city council. I said, Mayor, and we had another meeting one time, and we had it at the library down on, where it was across the street on Hollywood. Across the street mm-hmm. from City Hall. Mm-hmm. And that was talking about what they was going to do and everything. And he had a lot of the preachers out there. And he told them, say, you know what? Y'all got a young man in Dallas that would just be absolutely perfect on the city council because he's got a janitorial business and he knows a lot of the movers and shakers like the Stemmons and the Cullums and all those people. And said, he'd be good to help the community. And when he said that, we adjourned, and he called me that next morning, he said, Dave, I swear. He said, when I got back to my office, I had about five preachers and four or five different other groups called, said they didn't want you, you were too young, you didn't know nothing about the city and all that. And he said, well, if I was you, I wouldn't even think about never running for the city hall, but I can tell you, it's going to hurt Dallas. For somebody like you not to be there. So they don't like all that demonstrating and all that like Martin Luther King. Because, and the reason, the mentality that they had in Dallas, I can understand it. If white folks don't want to live next to you and you don't want to live next to them, first, you don't have the money to live the kind of community that they have.
Mm-hmm.
And the next is they got a right to live with somebody that they don't want to live next to. And that's the way life is. Birds of a feather flock together.
Amen.
And he said, now let me tell you how most of the wealthy and affluent Dallasite feel. Whatever y'all want to build in y'all's neighborhood, let us know and we'll help you.
Hmm.
Put it out there. I don't care what it is. If y'all want the same thing, we got it. We'll put it out there. And he said, but they don't want to do that. And that's why Dallas is like it is now, because they used to say that we were just like Atlanta, Georgia. But the difference is, in Atlanta, the white folks didn't want them to come to City Hall. They didn't want them to go into grocery stores, the clothing stores downtown. They didn't want them to do nothing. So our people were forced during those times to open up their own business. And that's why Atlanta now is a community that is equal to whites all over the country. They got their own subdivisions. They got their shopping centers. And most of the males in the last 50 years have been black.
That's right.
And that's the problem that our people don't know. And do you know what my grandfather told my daddy? Told my daddy, he said, I want you to teach our offspring. Stop hating white folks about slavery. That's over.
Right.
Use that energy in something that you can figure out that can help our people and make them know that we are important. And that's the mentality that I have right now. Do your part for your people, because if you really look at it now, just think about this. We didn't know it then. Suppose Dr. King had some businessmen with them instead of just the church members and the church preachers. And they said, well, look, we don't need to march and all that and have the dogs and all that. Let's build up our own community for ourselves. And guess what? They'll help us do it.
Right.
And we're not going to have all this stuff that we're having. And the minute that we start having businesses that can compete with the whites, guess what? They're going to let us in. No problem. Because that's the way America is. And even in slavery, what a lot of people don't know, that the American slaves made America what it is. It was the foundation of the economics of America. The one thing in the world that made more money than anything that ever existed was slavery.
Absolutely.
That's right. Wow. And that's what we got to get to. That's what we got to get to. And I like what you all are doing. The only thing I would like to see is more children to get involved early. And I've got some property that I'm working on now. And that's what we want to do. And there is a way, because in Dallas there is a shortage of affordable housing for our people. And right now, do you know that we have 300 people a week moving into Dallas?
Wow.
Some of them from overseas, some of them from Mexico, some of them from California, some of them from Canada, and they're coming in here because Dallas is one of the cities of the future. That's why you see what we build. Everywhere you look, somebody's building something in Dallas.
Right. And mostly south.
That's right.
That's where the land is.
That's right. You know what they did? The people that were mayors in the last 40 years, they were all in the construction business. And they started in North Dallas when they should have started in South Dallas and went north. And they'd have all those businesses that they got out in Plano and all back there. They would have been in Dallas County. But now, Dallas County really reached all the way to McKinney.
Mm-hmm.
If you go up there now, you'll see all that should have been in Southern Dallas.
That's right, where the land was available.
But you know what? I still think nowadays we have an opportunity to increase the value of our people and they will see that we're equal. Because when they start looking at what we've invented coming out of slavery, everything is different. The just one thing, take the electric lights and the safety lights at a stop sign.
Not a red light.
The red light.
Yeah.
And then also the guitar, the saddle, and just so many things that we invented. If they don't even like to, you know, let people know.
They don't want us to know anything.
No, they don't want us to know. But you know what? That's our fault. And I have a little project that I'm working on. And I'll tell you about it when you take
the okay.
Because we want y'all support in it. Because it's going to do just wonders.
Well, I don't care what it is. I am in support. Trust me. Yeah. Now, before I turn this film off, I want everybody to know your age.
My age, I am 86 in 5 months. I will be 87 years old.
And that'll be what? What's your birthday?
May 29th, 1930.
Wow. You are a blessing to the community, sir, and this has been a pleasure.
Yes.
And this will be shown for the rest of Black History Month in Dallas.
Oh, that's wonderful. That is wonderful. I really appreciate that.
Appreciate you.